Hello and good evening. Tonight I'm going to show you a hands-on demonstration or tutorial, if you will, of Redis. And Redis it's an insane fast key value store. It is usually used for caching or for storing single values, like it could be a web page count. It could also be used with message queues. It can be used whenever you need a key value store that is insanely fast. It can also be used for authentication. If you want to have a place where all your sessions are stored across your whole organization, then you can have a single sign-on system that actually signs you on in one system, and then you store it in this key value store, and then all other systems can then hook up to the key value store, and then they can see this user is entitled to do, and also that the user is authenticated. As usual, tonight we're going to use Docker. On Docker Hub, there is the official Redis image, which is just called Redis, which is here, and you can see it has been downloaded more than 10 million times. So this is what we're going to use tonight. Just to begin with, I'm going to make a drawing of what a key value store is. Most of you might already know it, but you can see here we have a Redis key value store. And it's actually just the purpose is actually just that you have a key, a unique name. It could be weather, and then you have a value that could be like summer, and then you have some applications around the Redis application that actually needs this data and also updates this data. The Redis key value store itself is written in C as language, and it's entirely in memory by per default. It's in memory. And it is possible to set up some persistence, and it's also possible to store the data as a file somewhere where you choose to dump the data if needed. But the main purpose is the main way of running it is actually just to run it in memory, and then if when the Redis database or when Redis key value store is stopped and started, then the data is gone. So that's usually it's usually used as a kind of a cache, but it is possible to persist data, and it's also possible to scale up and have multiple Redis instances running, and then have a master Redis instance that has the real value, and then the master can actually the Redis can actually give to copy all the data to other Redis key value stores, and these key value stores maybe they are persisting the data actually, while the main Redis is not persisting the data just for performance issues, for performance reasons. Then this Redis is not persisting the data, is just having it in memory. So when an application out here pushes a key value, then this Redis is very, very fast at storing it in the memory. And then afterward, when the request is done, this would usually give a result of one, because one row has been updated. Then the other Redis instances can then be updated with the same value, and then they can store it on disk somewhere. So that is actually set up, and then we have a second application here. Maybe this application actually needs to read instead of, maybe this was a set operation. Then we have a get operation over here, and then that gets the key value that we just set. I'm going to show this in the redis-cli, because there's a client in Redis, so I'm going to use to show you this in a client. I'm not going to show you how to use this in a Spring Boot application and Spring Boot setup in this tutorial. I'll make another one that will actually show that, but this will just show Redis and the redis-cli how it actually works. The homepage and where the documentation is located is in Redis on redis.io, and the documentation is really, really good. There's especially this commands tab where you can actually search for the command, like subscribe and publish, which I will tell you, which I will talk about a little bit later, publish. Then you can see the command here, and then the documentation is right here. So it's really, really good documentation they've made here. Yes, and then I want to also want to point out there's a web page called tutorials.com. It has a really, really good documentation and tutorial of all of the commands in Redis. But let's get started. The first thing we're going to look at is just strings, and all the values in Redis are strings. So when you set a value, then it's always considered a string inside Redis. I'll just show that now. And when I say string, then of course there can also be hash maps, which we're also going to look at in a moment. So it's not entirely strings. It's but let me show a hands-on experience here. What I've done right now, I've actually run the image like this: docker run minus name and then my Redis, and then I've opened up the port 6379. And then this is the name of the image name. And then I'm starting it as a daemon. Then what I've done here in my terminal is actually I'm just running a docker exec, then minus it, and then my Redis, that was the name of the container. And then I'm running a command inside the container. So this is the way that you can run a command inside a container. And then there I'm running the redis-cli like this. So we're actually running this inside the container. Let me just clear this. Let us set a value. This we can set the weather, and then we can set the value. We can use quotation marks if we want to, and then we can write rainy with a bit of sun. Then we are, and it's just like usual, and then we are guarded. Then we have not set too much. That's what I mean. Then we can write, if we don't know which keys are in our store, then we can actually just write keys, and then we need to write a pattern. And you can see here it actually helps me already. It says keys, and then in gray with gray characters, and actually shows that I need to give it a pattern. If you write star, then you get all. So right now we have a key called weather. So let us try to get weather. You can see here we get weather, and then we actually got the value of weather right here. So that's a normal way of getting and setting a key. I can try to make another one. Set tomorrow's weather, and then we set the value sunny, 30 degrees centigrade, like this. And then we can write keys again. Keys, and then the pattern, which is just star. Then we get all the keys. Then we can see now we also have tomorrow, and then we can say get tomorrow, like this, and then we get the value. So that's actually how it works. Get and set, just like in a normal hash map. If you're coding in Java or C or some other C++ or whatever program, all the programs they have hash maps. .NET also, of course, C#. That is the key value. Then let me show the next thing, which is the hashes. The hashes are complicated. The reason why they're complicated is that you actually need to understand that we have one key right here. Then inside this key, then you actually have another map. So you actually have a hash map in here. That means you have a key. Then you have a sub key here, sub key one, and then you have a value that can be like value one. And then you have another sub key two, which also has a value. So it's like having a hash map inside a hash map, if you've ever done that. So we have a key, and then we have a hash map inside that key here. But let me try to show that how that actually works. We have a command called hmset, which is hash map set. And then again, we can see here we get a code completion suggestion here that we need to write a key, and the key could actually be weather. Today, let's say that we're making some weather forecasts. So today, then we write rainy. Then we can make another one tomorrow. Cloudy, and some degrees. And then day after yesterday, let's say yesterday. And then we say what should be the snow. -5 degrees centigrade. Like this. So this means that we are creating this command actually creates a key, which is called, we need to give it a key. I forgot that. So let us call it forecast forecast like this. So we are creating a key called forecast, and inside this key, the value for this key is actually a hash map or hash, which is a set of key values here. So inside this key, we have key value sets, which is today rainy, tomorrow cloudy, yesterday as key, then the value is snow minus 5 degrees centigrade. Let us try to run this. Then we can actually write hget, and then we can say forecast. We can also make a get all if we don't remember the, like this, hget all. Then we get all the key values inside the hash map in the key called, with the key called forecast. So here we say we have a key called today, a value called rainy, a key called tomorrow, a value called cloudy, 15 degrees. But usually we're not interested in all the content, but yeah, we just want to have one. It's actually called a field. So in here, the key inside the hashmap here is actually called a field. So the forecast is a key, this is a field. And then we say that our field that we want is like today. Then we get only rainy. We can also say we want yesterday. Then we get snow, minus 5 degrees centigrade. Hashes are really, really used. They're used a lot, and the reason why they're used a lot is because they are very good at representing a bean, like a class in your code. So if you have a code, then you could have a field called today, another field called tomorrow, another field again called yesterday, and then this could be the values. I'll show this in the Spring Boot tutorial I'll do later on. But hashes are used a lot, so make sure you understand what's going on here. Let me just clear the output console here. That was hashes, and let me show you. Just check if there's anything I forgot. Of course, you can delete a key also. I'm not going to show that. Yeah, that's of course, there's a lot of functionality. But go into on tutorialpoint.com. They are really good with providing documentation on Redis. And a lot of other things as well. But let me just go to lists. Lists is actually just a list. It contains the row, the order that we are actually putting in the elements in. So we can push in elements. We can pop elements. The pop functionality will actually check the first element and remove. We can make a range where we get the range back. We can also set with the index command. We can actually set the value for a certain index. But let us just create the list here. L push. Then we can say lists. We can say ice creams. And here we can place some values like strawberry, vanilla, chocolate, and then we can say. To get all of them, then we can run the range command lrange, and then we can say we want the ice creams key, because we could have several lists in our key value store. This we need to always need to give the key. Then we write start, and that's a zero if you want the first one. Let's start with the zero as an index, and then we can just write 10. Then we get the first 10 elements. And here we have chocolate, vanilla, strawberry. If you want to add one, then we can just push another one. L push ice creams, and then we can push another one, which should be lacrosse, like this. Then we can get the range again. Now we have lacrosse also. It's also placed here. Now it's index one, so it's always pushed in the front. So when we are pushing something new in, let's create a new one. What should this be? Raspberry. Then let's get the range again. Raspberry. So now raspberry has the first element index. The index is actually zero, even though it shows this is just for viewing. Then it shows 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if you want to pop one, L pop. L pop like this. Oh. We need to write the key, of course, as usual, ice creams. Then we actually pop the raspberry, as you can see in the bottom. So it always returns the element that has been popped. And we can also go set the let's see this, we can see L, LZ, then the key and the index. So let's say that I want to change vanilla to something else, LZ, then I want to add ice creams, let's say, and that has the index 3. 1, 2, 3. That means that that is actually index 2. So then we want to set the value to something else, mango. And we do it like this, and then we can get range again, and then we can see now vanilla has been exchanged with mango. So that's how the list works. They're very simple, and they work. Pretty straightforward, I would say. Then we have a set. The difference between a set and lists is actually just that in sets, if you have in my list, I can actually have multiple values that are the same. I will just, if I want to, then I can actually create a L push. Then I can create another mango, ice creams, mango, and then get the list again. See, now we actually have two mangoes. One mango there, one mango there. In a set, that's not possible. So that if we do the same in a set, then we would just only get one mango. But let me just try this. That is just the sadd command, which is right here. Sadd ice cream. That's the, what should we write this time? Ice. What should we reduce? Games. Then we write Pac-Man. Then we write Sensible Soccer. Then we write Galaga. And then I write Pac-Man once more. So that means now we should actually have added two times Pac-Man. But you can see here the number actually says 3, even though that we actually have 4 elements. And that's because it's a set, so it's only unique values that can be in here. Then I'm going to write sget games. Oh, sRange. Let me just check. It's called sMembers, sorry. sMembers. Games like this, then we can see we only have one Pac-Man. And if I try to add one more Pac-Man here, it doesn't do it because it's we already have that value in there. I can try to add something else like 1942. Good game also. Now it adds it because it is it doesn't have the value already inside it. So sets are also very useful. High sorted sets, I would like to, I'm going to skip that. That's actually just where it's sorted, and then you can actually give it, okay, I'm not going to skip it. Let us just take it really fast. It actually gets a value. It actually gets a rating, a kind of rating here. So it actually, so when I create my lists, my sorted set here, then let's, what should this be? This should be movies. Then we actually give it a score. So we actually give it a score like 10. Then we write Ghostbusters. If I want to use spaces, then I need to use quotation. Ghostbusters, like this. Ghostbusters. So now I added this, and then I can list it all with the set range. Movies, 0 to 10. Ghostbusters, and then we can actually, let us make another movie. Let's add. That could be Fast and the Furious. Fast and the Furious. And then we give that a score of 5. And oh, I forgot the key. Movies. Like this. Fast and the Furious. And we give it 5. And I'll just delete this here. And then we get the range. So now we have Fast and the Furious, that is first because it has the lowest number. And then we have Ghostbusters because it has the highest number. Let's say we want one in between, that means we give it 7. So let's say that we add a movie, give it the score 7. And then we can call, this movie could be called maybe Terminator. Terminator has 7, so now this should actually show up in between, and it does. So the sorted set is also quite useful when you have something you want to rank, and that is often the case on web pages, of course. So there's the sorted set. The hyperlock, you need to read up on it yourself. Puppy subscribe, it's actually made for messaging, so we can actually subscribe to a channel, and then another channel can actually publish some stuff on this channel. So it's a good way of it's a way of sending messages to back and forth. So it means here I can actually subscribe to a channel called Movie Talk. Let's call the channel that. So now I'm subscribing to Movie Talk. Then I've cheated a little bit more here. I have another terminal over here, right here. Then I can actually write publish. Then I can publish something to our channel, which was called Movie Talk. And then I can write something like the new Terminator rocks. Like this. So now I've published it, and I can go to my first terminal, and I can see that because I'm subscribing to new messages, and I got this the new terminal rocks. I can send some more information like let's go to the cinema. This is also a well-known use case that so they can actually be used for as a message like a message system. So have a subscriber, have a publisher, maybe more publishers. Everybody can, there can be multiple. There's the same application could both subscribe and publish stuff on the same channel, of course. So this is also very useful for sending messages back and forth while listening for it. So yeah, let me show you something more. Transactions, very handy also. If you want to batch up the commands that we are running, then we start with multi, and then we end with exec, and then it actually does the commands that we are telling Redis to do. So that means that I'm just going to go out of this. The way to get out of a subscription is Control-C. Unfortunately, that also cancels the Docker command that I executed, so that's why I just needed to enter my Docker container again, like this. But let's say that we want to do a transaction. So if I write multi like this, then I've started my transaction. So this is like a begin transaction begin I just wrote there. Then I can write the set my key one to my value one like this. Then I can get my key one. And you can see nothing actually happens when I do this because it's just why it's queued. That's because we are actually creating a transaction. Then I can write exec when I think that my transaction is done, and then it actually executes the stuff that I wanted to execute. That means that I got my value back here. Transaction pretty simple from within the CLI, the Redis CLI. Backup. If you write save, very easy. Then it actually persists the memory data, then it persists the whole key value store to disk. And where it places it is actually where you have configured it to be. So that is, if I write config get dir, then you can see where it writes it. So in my case, it will write the RDB file. It will actually write a dump.rdb file, and it will write it, it will locate it under / data inside this Docker container here. Regarding config, you can create a config file and provide the Redis with the config file. That's the most usual way to do it, but you can actually also change, you can also get the configuration from a running Redis instance by writing config get, and then you can write the pattern that you want to get. And again, this is key value, so that means that if I go up in the top, that means that I have a DB file name that's a key, dump .rdb, that's the name of the file name. So if I want to change the file name, that need to be dumped when I write save, then I need to change this key here. Yeah, so that, and there's a lot of settings, of course, a lot of tweaking is possible. And you can write config and then set if you want to set a key, but I'm not going to do this right now because I'm going to talk about there's a ping feature, so you can see that everything is working. Ping tests, test 1, 2, 3. Then just write the same again. If you write ping, then just write pong. This actually, this says that I'm authenticated if that is needed, but per default, it is not needed to be authenticated, and there's no password set per default when you just start up with the default configuration. If you want a password, then you need to write auth. Then first you need to set the password, then you can log in with a password. I'm just going in with my password right now, and then the complaints, Redis complaints, I said you have not set a password. Authentication is actually not enabled because no password is set. So if I want to set the password, then I want to write config set, and then it says required Let me just get require. If there's something you can't remember, like now, then you can write config get and then the beginning and then a star. In my case here, it's require pass. I couldn't remember if it was required pass or require pass, but it's just require pass. So if I set this like config set require pass, and then I can set my password to something, my pass, or very secret, like this. Now I've set the password, and that means that if I'm writing ping now, I'm not authenticated because I have not given the password. So I'm writing auth, then I write very secret. I can also try with a wrong, with an invalid value first. Invalid password. So let's try again, auth, very secret, like this. And now I'm actually authenticated and I can write my ping, and then I can see I get pong back. So that's actually regarding the security. And that's also that scripting. I'm not going into that right now. That's how to connect to foreign servers instead of connecting to local server. But I think this is the main part that I will that I wanted to go through in this tutorial. I'll make another one how to actually wire this up with Spring Boot and to use the key value store with inside a Spring Boot application. Thank you very much for listening. Feel free to leave a comment in the YouTube channel if there's any questions. Thank you very much for tonight.